for the rest of our time here. So it's wonderful to be here. It's raining like crazy, and I'm coming from Portland. I thought that only in Portland it rains so much, and because in the summer it doesn't rain, and this is not Portland, I didn't bring anything that to prepare. But anyways, so I was speaking yesterday with Alain, and he asked me to present about Alexander Technique, because I have written a couple of articles about the Alexander Technique and how we apply it to string playing, and upper string playing in particular. And I think I would start with a disclosure that I'm not an Alexander Technique professional. I didn't do training, but when I was a student, I went from Argentina to Germany, and my professor at that time, Nicolas Machenko, he was a freak about Alexander Technique, and he highly encouraged us to do Alexander Technique. Russian, very strong teacher. You do what the teacher says, so without thinking, most of us did Alexander Technique and I did it for 2 years, and at the beginning it was something that you do weekly, as expensive as a private instrumental lesson. So at the beginning I was just seeing, you know, the dollars tick by the minute. But eventually, after 6 months or so, I started realizing what it was about, and it became, with the years, my most important tool to understand, to build my own technique and to teach. And because most of my students nowadays, maybe because I'm not that Russian hard teacher, don't end up taking Alexander Technique lessons, I have found ways to transmit some of the most common problems and solutions that we face as string players. And I won't start by explaining what the Alexander Technique is, because that's, maybe we get to that at the end, but that's rather difficult to explain with words. But rather than that, I will start by speaking about typical problems that we face as a lot to major or lesser degree experience in their playing. So one of the concepts is of allowing movements, and I will ask you a few times to come up and help me demonstrate something. Would someone, would you mind coming for a moment? You? Yeah, first of all. And I will ask you to push me rather hard, and first I will allow movement. Yeah. And now, again. So the second time, I'm allowing to move in whatever direction. What this means when we are playing is that a lot of times when we have a shift or a difficult bow stroke, we sort of lock our bodies minimally in anticipation of a difficulty. And in contrast to that, what we need to do is allow movement in every possible direction, sort of a marionette, which could move or not, but you have to be able to move in all possible directions. Thanks so much. Another central concept is about having force and power without too much of an active effort or without an unnecessary tension. And for that, I invite you to put the tips of your fingers together and start opening a circle in front of you. Open the circle that is forming here, bigger and bigger. And you might notice that there's a little bit more pressure in the tips of your fingers without you actively doing force towards that. So, and sort of by expanding all that, you're achieving a similar effect indirectly. In Alexander Technique, there's a central concept of the neck being free, the connection of the shoulders, the neck, and the head. And if you take ever an Alexander Technique, you will hear the teacher, the instructor saying again and again, release your neck so that the head can go forward and up. And it's crazy, it's so much about that. It will repeat, and that's the central concept of Alexander Technique. And to understand why that is so important in practical terms, I invite you just go a little bit forward in your chairs and tighten your neck. Bring it close to your shoulders as much as you can. And now bring your head, arms up, and wiggle your fingers. And now release everything. And wiggle your fingers. And you might realize that the motion is
easier, quicker, and that you reach farther. So imagine if there's only 3-4% of titanium in your plane, how much it affects your abilities. Another thing is, I'm not sure if you realize that when I did like this, even my voice changed. And that's Matthias Alexander, the person who developed this method. He was a theater guy, and he lost his voice. And because he went to all sorts of professionals, nobody could help him. He started looking at himself in the mirror and tried to discover what the hell he was doing that was causing the loss of his voice and him not being able to project. And he discovered that it was that sort of contraction of the neck. Another way to understand why this is so crucial is if you stand up, please stand up, and if you just, you know, bend your neck and do a slouch, sort of like this. But now try to do the same by all the time keeping your neck straight and your head going up. And if the experiment doesn't fail, it's pretty much impossible. You can't do a slouch while your neck, while you're feeling that vector going up. So this is super important, and this, you can see, there's this tendency, you know, from the, what is it called? Flight syndrome. I'm missing one verb. But you know.
Freeze.
Eh?
Freeze,
exactly, thank you. Syndrome that, you know, we do like this or we paralyze. And that's called stutter reflex, and it's very important if you're walking and see a rattlesnake, instinctively you stop. And that's useful, or if you're about to step into a cliff. But when we're about to go into an audition, when we are about to do a difficult shift, the minor paralyzation that we have in our body, it's going to cause the problem. So how can we avoid when we realize in our playing that we are doing this? And chances are that you don't realize this unless someone told you or unless you're checking very attentively a mirror or a video recording. But once you realize that you're doing sort of a contraction or you're bringing your shoulders up in difficult spots in the music, you can go stand up again, please. And if you bring your shoulders up, and now let them drop down, this is how you want to feel when you're playing the violin. It feels home, feels easy, feels safe, because it just cannot go anywhere from there, right? Now, this one we probably did a few times before, just bring your arm and let it drop, and hear the big clap against your body. And sometimes when you teach in the future, you will see some people that do. And if it doesn't, you know. So, and again, this feeling, do it one more time. That's, again, how we want to feel. So it feels easy, it feels natural in a way, and then we will do all these pyrotechnical and difficult things, but with this feel of ease. It's super basic, but that's, in my opinion, where it comes from and why when we see this fantastic players that we all admire, that nobody questions. They all have a different grip, they all hold the violin slightly different, they use shoulder rest or they don't, but that basic principle of easiness, of not using unnecessary tension is for the most part there. And you can see that many of those never heard about Alexander technique, but a lot of them just have it naturally. Most of us do not, and we have to find some way, some techniques to make it easy, to make it work for us. Another typical tendency to different degrees is to press too much in the chin rest unnecessary, or to tighten the thumb. What you can do to avoid or to check if that's what's happening, you want to play passages while with the head out of the violin. Yes, the thumb is going to have a completely different responsibility. And you can, you know, try to speak while you're playing a passage, try to read something loud. You know, it's a little bit of this kind of thing, but besides the stupid ability. It makes you aware of how much and how little and what's the responsibility of the head. And you know, when you come down here, a head is heavy enough to hold the violin, so make sure that you don't press. And for a lot of people, it even changes the sound of the instrument when you start applying force here. Another thing that you can do for fun is put something in your teeth, because a lot of people do this when they practice or when they perform. So, cracker, whatever, piece of plastic. The thing is being aware, and being aware is 50% of solving the issue, especially repeatedly being aware. After 100 times that you find yourself doing a unnecessary habit, suddenly you start getting, your body starts getting a new, hopefully positive habit. One thing that I find extremely useful, because it summarizes and gets together a lot of what I'm talking about, is practicing on the floor. Do you ever practice lying down? So a lot of the work in an Alexander Technique session happens with the student lying down with the knees like this, hands in the belly, a book under your head, and the teacher will say, and with their hands they will move and make sure that you're not holding unnecessary tension. But beyond that, I found that practicing on the floor, and I first heard this from Anna Chumachenko, I'm not sure, she's not extremely popular here, but in Europe she's like teacher of superstars and beyond. She does that a lot. Some of her students, tell me, I mean, Sarah Chang studied her, what's this, Julia Fischer, do they ring a bell? Lydia Balashvili. She insists a lot of that. And the good thing about when you do that is, well, first of all, it feels like practicing on the moon, because gravity is playing all sorts of crazy things with you. But doing like this when you're playing, or doing like that, becomes especially stupid. And you realize it right away, because gravity will tell you something, and this doing this in the floor becomes more apparent. So, any volunteer to try that? Yeah, please. So if you know why you're doing that, and other benefits, your lower back will be touching the floor. A typical problem is people, you would need a violin. Is arching too much the back, yes, or tightening the back. A lot of us, when something difficult comes, like we do like that it would help for anything. I mean, unfortunately, it doesn't match because it breaks the connection with the floor. One more experiment while we're speaking about this. Stand up, please. And go a little bit into your knees. As you do so, you might realize that it feels as if in the sole of your feet there will be a little bit more of weight. Yeah? And when you go back up, try to keep that. And another thing, that when you're bending your knees a little bit, is pretty much impossible to tighten your back. Now go straight, tighten your knees, tighten your back. Yeah? And now do the opposite, release your knees and let all the weight go into the floor. So when you're practicing, experiment with that and try to find yourself those moments when you are doing the opposite and losing the contact with the floor. Don't start playing all the time like this. Sometimes I tell that to students, and the next time they are all over the place. It's not about that, it's about the feeling that you might get when you're doing these things. Why don't you try them? So now you can get you. Yeah, I'm trying to play something. You can go just a little bit closer to the chair. It's not easy.
All right.
stop there.
Release, enjoy that your shoulder blades. Wait, release your back also.
Okay.
Okay, and enjoy that the shoulder blades can rest.
My legs okay? Or
you can put them like this, with the sole of your feet on the floor.
Okay. I just don't want to step on your.
Should be fine, it's $2. Yes, and enjoy the yoga mat, shoulder blades on the. Okay. And so enjoy that support, enjoy your lower back having the support of the floor. Okay, and now try again. And don't tighten what I just mentioned, yeah?
Okay.
No, don't get nervous, don't play out of tune for once.
Which is a lot of problems.
Okay. Is it short? Okay. Try. I will help you with the violin, just
okay.
I'm covering it. Okay, try one more time, like this. Just. Play an open string. Feel the connection to the floor is if you don't go too far. I want to make another experiment. Let's try here. Yeah, if you squat again, your thighs will be working very hard, but it's letting go. All your upper back, the lower back is touching the wall. And you let all your upper body rest there, yeah? And this is also a very good way to feel that connection with the floor. And I'm not sure if you realize also my voice, when I was letting go and getting that support gets more body. Take care with the ball. One way to realize how much extra tension that we don't need, again, we are using muscles, we are using tension in violin playing, there's no doubt about that, we are looking for that unnecessary. So let your elbow rest here. Let all the way, and try to play, I don't know, a scale or an arpeggio, and let all the way here. Also ask a colleague to hold your gimme all the way. Yeah, and do the same. good. He's letting go.
Yes.
A lot of people, when you, if you want to try that for a few minutes with a colleague, you will realize that before the shift.
Yeah, with the colleague, yes.
Say that again?
Yeah, with your hand, it's a little easier to know.
Right, right. And it's a little bit more natural than if you're using the piano with a few books or a stand, but they can give you feedback if you're tightening that. And the same you can do with the bow. Because, again, a lot of times we sort of start holding in with our shoulder blades just, you know, a couple of millimeters up out of insecurity, and that's why a lot of people, when they're a little bit nervous, intonation goes higher and higher. Yeah? Thanks a lot. Do you guys have any questions so far before I keep talking and talking? No? Complaints? Sorry, come one more time. another way to realize if you're holding a little bit more than enough is if you ask someone, I will hold here the violin and you will hang from there, sort of if you're from a cliff all the way.
Oh.
You know? Yes, exactly. And now more closer to what's real life with the tip of your finger and then all the way. Yes. And that's a good way to realize if you turn around. All the way. How, you know, here is everything relaxed, it's in the lowest point. And this is way more than enough to bring down the string. And the action here has little to do, you know, with, I was told to a student who actually grew up in the farm, for me it was always a sort of picture that I didn't know if it's true, like if you put the tendons of a chicken leg, like, you know, it closes like that. In violin playing, there's nothing like that necessary. Yes, that action is from here, and that's a good way to feel it, yes? So, not from the thumb, not this thing. And another thing that can help body mapping is also a technique that was developed from Alexander Plejnik later on, and it's a little bit different than Alexander Plejnik. They go from the premise that if you understand how the body works, that by itself improves the way you use your body. And an example of how they go about it is, for example, thinking, if I tell you where do the fingers start?
It's like here, but not.
Eh?
Here? Well.
Yeah. So it's complex, but the thing is, if you turn the hand around, you see that the fingers actually start sort of here. Yeah? And actually, like you said, the skeleton goes like this, and here are a lot of fiddle bones, so the action starts here.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times we have misunderstandings about, not that we need to scientifically understand it to the last detail, but major misunderstandings about where the finger action starts, and that self-cheating or unknowing is called provokes a misuse of the body. Another typical is to know where exactly the head balances in the neck. Anyone knows how to find that spot? So if you put your fingers here behind your earlobes and you think that line right in the middle, which is slightly below the nose, that's where the head balances with the column, yes, with the spine. And if you do slight motions now with that understanding, sort of above, you know, those balls that are turning on top of a fountain of water, imagine it that way, that's one way that can help some of us to understand better what's what. I might need you again. So, another typical problem that I saw also today morning is locking the elbow in a certain position. We many students, you know, just let the elbow and try to adapt the fingers,
which causes a lot of times that the wrist ends up in something like that, and the fingers in something like this. One way to avoid it is, you know, just exploring the range of motion and making sure that you don't find yourself stuck in one place. It's like, you know, if you want to go there and you get one leg fit, that's what you're doing, sort of, when you let the elbow just in one position and trying to solve everything else here. So a lot of times, like Heifetz is, I think, one of the best examples, like he's like this, and it doesn't mean that you need to copy everything, but, you know, when you're going up, you know, and that's something that a lot of people don't avoid, and that's the problem is that, depending on the technical stuff that you need to solve, but we need the third and fourth here. Yeah? Does it make sense? Any questions? So it's not a solution for everything because technique is very complex. A lot of times you want vibrato, and that's fine. A lot of times you have an arpeggio, and that's fine because the hand sort of glides better in this position. But everything that we have force, when we have the fourth finger, we need to play in tune, or the second finger, not too sharp, or we need the intonation that is, you know, very pure on the spots, not like Brahms sound, but rather Mozart sound. I prefer using more the finger coming this way, and therefore we need to explore that. Same thing here, just explore with a mirror, with a camera, just do some abstract exercises and make sure that you're not too up or too down with your elbow. Find what's useful for you. And to get a basic idea of how the hand, in my opinion, feels what most of the time when you're playing, is if you let your hand like this. And you feel that it's super nice and comfy and easy. And when you're practicing, stop in the middle of a difficult passage, get this feeling back that every one of you is having right now, and go on and stop, you know, half a minute later and check. If it's fine, you go on. If not, you know how it feels. You know how to get there. And if you don't remember it, try it out. So super easy, super stupid exercises, but the ground of technique should be super easy. Should look easy, should feel easy, because when we're on the stage with all sort of real life problems, from the challenges of a piece, from the circumstances of a concert, that's what gives us, makes it possible feeling at home. I mentioned the typical problem of clenching with the thumb. Any one of you do you catch yourself sometimes pressing too much with your thumb? Any solutions that you have encountered? So one is, an easy and nice one is to play the same passage without the thumb. Yes, your head will have a little bit more responsibility, but more than anything is realizing a few things. Well, first that you don't, how it feels not to clench with your thumb, what the mechanic is here, but also where the thumb needs to be, because again, a lot of times your thumb is going to be just randomly stuck in one position and not helping the hand, especially up here. Feel what these fingers need and then put the thumb. Yeah, if you don't use shoulder rest, I agree, it's a little bit tougher, there's some other considerations. Another one is putting a Sharpie underneath here, because if you have it here and you start doing the nutcracker, it's going to be especially ridiculous. Some people start with beginners. When you start teaching, it's a little mouse puppets or whatever you call it, not alive, not dead either, like the plush thing. so that they learn from the beginning not to be tied there, and you will realize a lot of times when you guys have chords, and so on, typical instinct of everyone is like, shit, you know, and press. And if you don't do that, chances are that intonation, you can have a better start at that. With TENS, you all know, I'm sure, retro extension is a way to feel how you can do the same thing with less effort. You know, if when you're trying to reach hard, it feels like tight. You know, if you do the opposite, starting with the fourth, places the elbow in a nicer way, and it feels like letting go more than stretching for a trying hard. Do you know what I mean? Now to the bow arm. When you stand one more time, do this one. And try to lift these things nice and easy in the spring. So when you're playing, remember this feeling. Because a lot, one of the problems that I see, and I have to admit that there's a lot of great violins out there that do it, and it sort of works, great, but I wonder how it would be without it, is if you put your hand in your armpit, squish this group of muscles, and now move this. Do some of you realize that there's sort of a tightening here? Hands up who feels that sort of little spasm. Raise your hand so that I know. Yeah? So that little spasm is not particularly useful in violin playing. It can create a little undesired accent. It gets in the way of sound. How do we get rid of it? Well, it takes several months. I would start without the violin, doing this, and once in a while you will realize, what? It didn't happen. And the more times you can get, eventually you can decide, I want to move that muscle, I want not to engage that. And I think it's interesting, it's this one, yeah? Also, body mapping would say, okay, the arms start right here, yes? That's where they start. You can do also what I was saying at the beginning with this arm, lean it somewhere, find a nice platform, put some books or ask a friend, and try how it feels if you're letting go. Another thing, would you mind one more time? Without the violin. In an Alexander technique session, a lot of times the teacher, if it's okay for you to keep your arm and move along. Okay. And let everything hang. No, but don't help me. So, you see, a lot of times the Alexander technique teacher will move around, let go, and don't predict the motion that I'm doing. Let go. So a lot of times if you do that with a colleague, a friend, you will realize that they can tell you when you're double guessing which direction the person is going, and then get us at the beginning when I started talking of letting go like a marionette and that feeling of not having little blockage. Is that a word? Blockade? Or you know what I mean. Thank you so much. Another way, sorry to give you so much information, I hope you can digest it over time. To avoid this thing that so many people do, it's not the solution, but it's something to make you keep you thinking. Put a back, hand back on your shoulder, and that will make you be aware that you start rising. And when you stop doing that, you will realize all sort of abilities that you need with your hand, with your fingers, to really do the fine details in music, because with here it's like bending, you only will get so far with this range of motion. So, and when you get to the need of getting finer here, there's all sort of exercises from Menuhin about sort of pedagogical sources that you might know, but it starts, you know, with the windshield wiper, this one, you know, this one. Then without the thumb, take care. 1, 2, thumb, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, thumb, 3, 4, 1, 2, thumb. And when you get bored, you turn
they go around and start doing all these things.
Yeah. Another exercise, not really Alexander technique, but it helps feeling how the sound comes from the floor, which at the beginning sounds like metaphysics and bullshit. But if you feel it like any metaphysics, I guess, it becomes real. And I heard this, who was it? I think it was again Anna, either Anna Chumachenko or Shumel Ashkenazi, grabbing the ball like this. Have you done this? Then going to these knuckles, but getting the same feeling of boldness, of direct. And then going to the normal bow hold. And I think that comes from Pablo Casals, that exercise, and it's a nice way to feel how it, when it gets to the extremities, you still have that imminent connection from the floor. No questions so far, complaints? Sure. Yeah, please.
Could you talk a little bit more about finding the weight of the head?
The weight of the head?
Using the weight of the head to hold the head.
I would say it's as little as possible. No pressure whatsoever, it's just a lot of times it's ridiculous. You know, as teachers, we a lot of times think, don't say the nose. Try to teach not saying nose. But unfortunately, in real life, as soon as you stop doing any bad habit, the right thing is there. In other words, Alexander Technique departs from the concept that everyone is born with more or less some sort of natural ability in the use of their body, and that through misuse of our bodies, through the years, we ring that path that, let's say, a parent never ring. In terms, so I would say that as long as we are not pressing this, yes, or doing this, the right thing will be there. Yeah. So as soon as you're not pressing, everything is fine. And it sounds easy, it is simple, but it's not. If you're doing it, it's a pain to get there, and it will take, if you're used to that, it will take hundreds of times of catching yourself doing something not ideal until you say, oh, okay, that's what it takes not to do it. Does it make sense? So it's all of what I'm talking is not rocket science. It sounds simple, but to improve, and there's no, it's not that like, okay, you get there, you can play. It's a lifelong, it's like constant balance. You're all the time learning. And a teacher is essential, can be essential in pointing out some of these things, but nobody can get better than yourself in getting to know yourself. More questions?
So when I'm nervous, I start to shake very easily. Mm-hmm. Is there a way to counteract that in the right arm, especially the lower region of the bow?
The lower?
On the region of the bow?
I think it's not a simple solution because all the body is involved, and you heard me say five times from the floor, what the heck is that? I think that's a principle. Very principal thing comes from letting go, because a lot of times if you're not having that support, it starts. It has to do a lot of times depending on the person on holding the shoulder blade. As soon as we are holding, we are not comfortable. So at the minimum, it's like those old vinyl players. The minimal, unevenness. Shoulder blade, and then nice and easy here. Keep breathing. cars, the airbag thing in the car, or in the car that you have this system that is checking all the time, all the systems, and there's a light, if anything, your mind has to be like that, okay, you know, feet, knees, is it not, no, great, so lower back, am I letting go, or am I things like this, shoulder blades, this, but go out, again there, and eventually, hopefully, you get sort of a balance, you know, it's not, you get there and it's, you know, it solves everything, but kind of a check and when it works, you know, it's not like playing without powers, on the contrary, you're really able to bring all the energy to the plane without getting stuck somewhere. And it's all about the music, and the good thing is that the sound tells you right away if you're tightening something, if you're pressing too much, and that's ideally the best light that it will tell you right away. And through doing this, intuitively your body starts knowing, okay, and you just let go before you intellectualize it. But it took me a lot of work on myself. There's, for most people, a lot of these little things where each one can, you know, find their own places where you can develop. Let me check here. Another thing, speaking about that connection that you can check to see if you're tightening is if you play and rotate your torso or just rotate your waist, or if you play and do squats or play and walk. And a lot of people have that. They tighten somehow in their waist and it translates in the sound. Or when they move, this happens because, you know, it's not complete. This is not completely free. Have you seen that? Yeah. When you're sitting in the orchestra, I mean, again, there's many ways to do it, but I like going rather to the front of the chair. Yeah. A possibility is also having the chair a little bit like this, so that you feel like your legs could go any direction. It's not about moving necessarily, but the possibility of movement. And, you know, you might find yourself doing a little bit like that. And the thing is, from Alexander Technique, what feels normal, what feels natural, a lot of times is us self-deceiving, because for us it's normal whatever we are used to, and it will be normal until someone that for some weird reason we trust says it, or much better until we see ourselves in a video or a mirror that we are doing something. So I'll just do, how much time do we have?
About 45 minutes.
So I will close with some remarks, 10 minutes, and then I would like to have maybe 3-4 of you play a little bit, like 2-3 minutes, to see if, you know, we can point out some of these things that I have been talking about. So if you ever take an Alexander Technique, and again, this is not, doesn't intend to be a replacement for Alexander Technique, it's just some more practical way, because believe me, as much as some of this might sound metaphysical, if you go to an Alexander Technique coaching, you say, well, what's what? You're like, it seems everything, like, because a lot of those things you won't feel right away. Takes time, but I think actually I will skip that part, because I think we sort of covered it. But think of what if you lay down 5 minutes, and let's call constructive rest, what you were doing at the beginning without the violin. I recommend that you do that a couple of times a day, and think like a starfish, like every part of, you know, your arms, your extremities are moving away from the center, sort of vectors, and there's more space in your joints. don't do anything actively, don't move it, because it's not about that. It's about feeling of more room in the joints. So it's more about a picture that will change. Or if you stand up and for a moment think of only your right arm, yes? And think how you can close your eyes if you want, and feel how bring your awareness to your right shoulder and feel that there's more room every time and that it goes lower and lower, but don't move anything, just feel. And now with your attention go to your elbow and feel how it's free and there's more room in that joint, and picture all the little bones around your wrist and feel the weight. And go to the bones that connect to your first phalanges and get more room there, and now go to the second phalanges. Feel the also now the sole under your feet, or release your knees a little bit. And now go to the last phalanges before the tip of your fingers, and just feel that they can be freer. There's more room there. And for you, for some of you, when you open your eyes, you might realize that your right hand is either lower than the left, or that it feels freer than the left hand and the left arm. And you can do that with different parts of your body, and that's a way to show how your understanding and how your imagination can greatly affect the use of your body, and has little to do with a technical mechanical exercise. And that's why a lot of these are called indirect procedures, because it's not you directly trying to reach lower, but allowing to reach lower or reach farther with less effort, because everything that you were doing had more with letting go rather than trying hard. So you can see it. This almost seems like a religious service. Let me see if there's anything else. Well, when you're working with that, on this, if you think that any of this is useful for you, and you're welcome, there are some sheets there from an article that was in the Strat in December, or if you Google in the Strat search thing, there are articles that go through many of these exercises, and you find some of those useful. I recommend that you work on one or two at a time and post it, because as soon as we have the music in front of us, it's like the sugar, the carrot, and our life becomes the music, which is fine performance, but to change any habit, we need to be 5% in the music, 95% in the way. Because as soon as we try, as much as we can, as hard as we can, we only use the habits that we already have. So post-its, record yourself all the time, which I'm sure you do, mirror a lot, keep having advice. I would recommend that sometime in your life you try, let's say, you know, 6 Alexander Technique sessions, or Feldenkrais, or body mapping. Yoga looks for the same thing, completely different way, but something that gives you another perspective, that this thing that you have been hearing us speak over and over the years in violin lessons. This doesn't start when you grab the violin, it starts when you wake up, the use of your body. If you know, you're only like that, it becomes something very special to play the violin and have normal. So be aware during the rest of the day, observe great players. Many of those, again, never had Alexander Technique, but use those same principles of avoiding unnecessary efforts. Have a lot of patience with yourself. I'm the most impatient person in the world. Crazy, but not when I'm practicing, not with my students, because for good, it just doesn't get anywhere. The body has its own way of learning and has nothing to do with impatience. You cannot force it. Yes, you can practice 8 hours a day, but with patience. Constructive rest, do a lot of breaks, drink a lot of water, do sport. If you're practicing 5, 6, 7 hours a day, your brain needs to, you know, get something normal. So water and sport has helped me through the years. I think that's it from my part. Why don't we have a few of you play a little bit? Get that feeling at least. Okay. That's the idea, yes? Another thing that you're doing. Did you hear anything with the sound? That's the idea, yes? Because when you're doing a and press a little bit, the sound gets a little bit nasal, yes? Another thing that you're doing is you're articulating every single bow stroke like a little whip. Not sure. I enjoy playing Bach with baroque bow. I encourage you at least experiment once in your life. No need to do that little whip. When you start, last thing, and again, it's just things to think about. It's not right or wrong, and it's a balance. It's not like, you know, you shouldn't balance. That's great that this thing is, but just the sound, you know. When you started playing, your shoulder was very tight. Then as you played, it improved. I also encourage you to sometimes at least try. Not a lot of ladies play with high heels and play great, and that's fine, but at least when we practice, sometimes take off your shoes and feel the floor. I'm sure that it doesn't get easier when you're like this. So try one time, trying to balance through these different thoughts. Let's go. And check high fets, oyster play. The distance between the hairs and the stick, not all the violinists, different schools, different professionals, but a lot of great players don't get with the stick closer to the hairs and still get a huge sound. That sound makes intonation go all over the place, even if the fingers are right here, and gets a sound that is like that, maybe has something connected to loudness, but not quality, no openness, and it doesn't, it's out of tune and doesn't travel really nice. So, in few words, don't press with here, let the sound come from. Perception of power and, you know, okay, brilliance in a lot of
pieces translate in real life to, yes, in dropping the ball from the air a little bit. And when it's not forbidden and eventually can be sort of offish, that's what troubles could, that's what's precise, that's what we can control. So you feel what's coming, release here and feel of going down and around. And then you go. Yes?
Yeah.
And last thing is when you're playing in the G string, it seems like it's a little bit. So the first thing of playing from the string is it of, yeah? Has to do with ability of placing the voice. Yes, and not doing like this what I was speaking. Then when you have the super bad, yeah?
his super tag here. Try without the thumb. Better, right? So, things to think about, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, someone else? Finger, a lot of violinists play that measure second smaller than it should be. That intonation is a very subjective matter. I won't speak about that today, but when you're super bored and cannot sleep, Google Pythagorean intonation, just intonation, temperate intonation, and if you understand anything, you will be already asleep because it's super complex. But intonation is very subjective, but we have the open strings, and for this repertoire, we really want to play, you know, a D and an E, or a G and an A, where they really are resonating, yes? So it has to be a little bit wider than many violin students do, and for that, this might help you. And when you're going up, because you realize that it wasn't so in tune, make sure that you free your thumb, so that you can really go where you need to be, yes? Can you start again? Wait. Bring the violin to you. Don't go to the violin. Yes. Well, don't go. And a lot of these things is again catching yourself because everybody. Yeah. Breathe. Wait. Stay there. And a lot of times it's helping to stop in the moment and when I just yeah okay and release your shoulder a little bit. Yes? And keep breathing. Okay, wait.
you realize that A and G was a little bit out of tune, right? I encourage you to have the feeling, release your shoulder blade. No, 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 don't do fancy things. Just give me the weight. Okay. Release the shoulder, the thumb a little bit. Okay, give me the weight. She's completely floating there. Please give me the weight. Not nothing happening yet, please. There we go. A little bit, release your head. I'm holding your body. Yeah, release your head, release your left shoulder. There we go. That's good. Okay. Breathe and try it. Give me your weight. She's okay, there we go. Okay. I know it's a lot. Not easy to do. Breathe and go. There's no dogmas. If it's in tune, nobody will come and check and come so close to you, yes? But don't check those things, because sometimes we are doing things, putting some fingers down, and that makes it out of tune. Go on. Okay, that is not perfect in tune. Give me the word. Yes, I'm release the shoulder, this shoulder. As soon as we try to do this and start doing this with fifths, doesn't work in real life. Yes, we don't have time to do this, and when you have it like this and you have a contract of 3 minutes, your hand gets very tight because blood cannot go. Yes, so it has to be something close to normal. Doesn't feel good for half an hour. Yeah? Very good. And again, a lot of the things, a lot of patience, because it's hard as hell to change these little things, but you see that indirectly it's fixing intonation and it's fixing sound. More than if you say, no, it's out of tune, no, not out of tune, boom, boom, and keep doing the same, just trying to get it in another place, because it was other things that are in the way, doesn't make sense. Yeah. One more person or you are fed up. You want to play? Yeah. Any questions or complaints so far? Doesn't
this doesn't mean that clubs is useful for everyone. Some of you might have, I don't know. And there's many people, Menuhin tries to go through this completely different way, and these with these wrong motions, situations who then tell me what is his name, more like a
like throwing more than, you know, really, you know, like the hammers in the piano. Super clear articulation, releasing right away. It's more like dropping. So there's no clarity. When you start again, I will be a little more clear. To mention the other two things that I want you just to be aware. You have the tendency to arch a little bit your back, towards the back. Again, if it works for you, who knows, that's the best. But I would explore, instead of doing like this, you know, just coming more to a center. And the last thing, very nice, but a lot of times, but a lot of times I find you doing like this. So explore if, you know, nice, flexible, easy, that's great, and keep it. But nowadays, speaks like that. You try not to move more than necessary. So moving a lot doesn't, yes, great for you, you're free, but it's a little bit, it gets a little bit weird in real life. So as little motion as possible, it's a good idea here, yes. So not too much like this. Yes, yes. Hey, hey. Super important, and you guys, I'm sure you do Shradi and Shepshik and all those things on your life. But when you do so, know why. Yes, this kind of, how you say it?
Flossing,
yes? And learn what it teaches you, you know, about the thumb. So, I think you understood, and again, it's something, not a dogma, but I just would explore what happens if you play a little bit less like this and find more a situation of less carbs. We spoke about this, and this one we didn't speak much, but I would encourage you to do the thing on the wall so that you see if it helps you, because your salt is not squeezed, it's good, but it's not very, it doesn't open up. It's missing like a little bit of body, and I wonder if, you know, you will, why don't we try that? To the beginning, going to your knees. Shoulder width. Your feet. Yeah. Not like this. Bravo. You started great. Don't chicken out when you go high. Okay, stop there. Before the last note. Okay, there. Stop there. Get in your knees. Feel. Okay. Now, first note dissonance has to speak. Leaving tone. To. Very good, but in the E string, not yet. Can you play the last note? Wait, stop there. Okay, getting you your knees a little bit. Give me the weight. She's like this. Do the opposite. From here. Can you do like this? You're doing like this. Do like this. Just for fun. Very good. Okay, I'm impressed with the index for now. Wait, the same note. Wait, you're arching again. Okay, one more time. Wait a second. Give me the weight. Wait. I'm going to press it here, yes? Just with the index, you just tell the ball. Don't go there. You just guide it. Yes, one more time. But don't flautato. Bravo. Yes. You just tell the ball, keep there. Otherwise, it just goes there. But that's the only thing, you know. One last time, the ball. Don't know. See that he's again like that. Yes, and it checks a little bit here. Yes, the shaking, I think, is the index, not just telling the ball, not pressing, but telling the ball the way. Right, that's it. Very good. Thanks a lot for bearing with me. Sorry for the much blah blah. I look forward to seeing you in the little lessons and chamber.